Johnson County dropping its mask order. Kansas City dropping old capacity restrictions. Are we headed for a confusing mess? We look at what it means to you. Plus, another week of violence and another week of condemnations and messages of enough is enough. But will anything change? Those stories and the rest of the week's news straight ahead.
Week in Review is made possible through the generous support of Dave and Jamie Cummings, Bob and Marlise Gourley, the Courtney S. Turner Charitable Trust, John H. Mize, and Bank of America N.A. co-trustees, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Nick Haines, and it's great to have your company on our journey together through the news of our week. Jumping on board with us for the next 30 minutes from KCUR News' Steve Kraske, whose station is at the centre of one of the biggest stories in our city this week. We'll get to that in a moment. Also with us is 41 Action News investigative reporter Kat Reid, the editor of our African-American newspaper, The Call, Eric Wesson, and KNBC9 chief political reporter Micheal Mahoney. Up first, if you're told you don't have to wear a mask anymore, would you still wear one? Starting this weekend, one of the biggest parts of our metro dropping its mask mandate. Johnson County leaders voting to remove face covering requirements that have been in place since June. But private businesses can still require you to do so, and county leaders strongly recommend you continue to wear them. So if that's the case, why drop the mask mandate at all, Kat Reid?
Well, the original plan was to drop it when the vaccination rate reached 50%. They're currently at 42%, but health leaders expect it to hit 50% by the end of April. So this is following the original guidance, but I know there are a lot of people who probably do want to see the mask mandate continue.
Now, big stores like Target and Costco are still going to require you, Steve Kraske, to wear masks. Businesses can still decide whether to, you know, to do that. But isn't this going to put a lot of pressure on those frontline workers who are already lowly paid, who may have already been abused during this time by customers unhappy with these policies, and now they have to police this whole system?
Oh, absolutely, Nick. You feel for those folks, and you feel, you know, for leaders who have tried to navigate this pandemic. Look how much confusion there is out there right now about what rules are in place and what municipalities. If we're confused, some of us on this panel still are, I can only imagine what the average citizen is out there. The folks who are going to take the brunt of that are those frontline workers who have to, you know, tell people coming into a store, hey, you got to get a mask on. People, with all this confusion, there's going to be a lot of anger there.
You know, I was expecting this week actually also for Mayor Quinta Lucas to announce that they would also be dropping their mask mandate. That didn't happen, Micheal Mahoney. Instead, we have the mayor talking about relaxing almost every other restriction on businesses, including for the first time, no capacity limits at businesses, bars, and restaurants.
And hopefully, this is a moment of relief for them. We still have to be safe, but it's relief.
Does that mean that restaurants can bring back all of those tables they removed during the course of this pandemic?
That's my understanding of it, Nick. Everything is pretty much off the table in Kansas City, Missouri, save for this indoor mask requirement. Steve's point to the pressure being on workers in some of these shops is right on the button, though. It's going to be terribly unfair on those folks.
And the other issue, Eric Wesson, is the fact that in Kansas City, Missouri now, yes, the businesses are supposedly, looking at news reports, delighted, thrilled to bits that these restrictions are going away, but they can't find people to work. They're trying to bring people back. There's no one available to do that.
Yeah, and that's been a problem. And I was noticing a Facebook post for the Peachtree restaurant, and they're closing now on Monday and Tuesday because they don't have enough staff to make it work. So a lot of restaurants are saying they can't find people. And I don't know whether that's because of the COVID funding that went into making it more feasible to be unemployed and draw unemployment than it is to work. I don't know what the rationale is. But one of the things that the mayor didn't touch on specifically was churches and funerals. What's going to be the rules and regulations for church? Because a lot of people that we talked to are ready to go back to church.
Eric, he did mention weddings in there, and sort of parenthetically, I think he's referring to churches there, but you're right, he didn't bring it up. The other thing on this shortage of a wait staff is the fact that it's a waiter's market right now on this. Restaurants are, a lot of them are having to pay more than they used to for their wait staff. And the concern is, number one, can I swing that financially? And number two, what happens in a year from now or something like that when the market changes and we got folks on a wait staff that are making $20 an hour, and that's not the usual in this market. So they're kind of concerned about a shortage of folks.
More lives destroyed this week by violence in Kansas City. Our friends in public radio were mourning the loss of one of their own. KCUR reporter Aviva Okeson-Haberman was killed after a stray bullet reportedly pierced the window of her first-floor apartment in the Santa Fe neighborhood near 28th and Benton Boulevard. She was 24 years old. Just as Mayor Lucas was condemning the act that took her life, his own neighborhood was disrupted by violence. The mayor lives in the 18th and Vine Jazz District. Police closed off the area late Sunday night after a dispute outside a business left one person dead and three others with gunshot wounds. That quadruple shooting claimed the life of a former star quarterback at Center High School, who's the owner of Powerhouse Gym in Raytown, Missouri. Gary Taylor was 34 years old. Steve Kraske, I just wanted to start with you because you are at the station where Aviva died. What has been the response there this week?
Well, it's been crushing, Nick. I don't know how else to describe it. Infuriating, disheartening, all those things. And I think the emotions we're all experiencing there have been experienced hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of other times by families in our community in the last few years. And I've been heartened by the community's response. So many folks reaching out, a woman in the grocery store last night, a card I got in the mail last night from a person I didn't know, the crossing guard outside the elementary school when I ride to the office in the mornings. People are clearly reeling at KCUR this week. It's been a rough week.
And Eric Wesson, the mayor, saying this week, of course, that every single one of these murders in Kansas City this year and in the past, they all have a story behind them. But after all of this, we have lots of talk of condemnation. Tut, tut, tut. Why do we allow this to happen? But any talk of any policy changes as a result of this?
Well, there's a couple of things. I talked to City Councilwoman Melissa Robinson this week. One of the interesting things that we talked about was privatizing the streets where people come into, because then they would be subject to searches. And then there's this million-dollar question about why we can't have enough police presence down here.
Part of the police presence, though, the mayor talking about the fact that a lot of people don't want to see, you know, 50 more officers over at the 18th and Vine Jazz District as a result of this.
Yeah, there are differing opinions as to what needs to be done. The one thing everyone agrees on, and the mayor vocalized, is that what's happening now is clearly not working. But the problem is with an issue like crime, you need to find both short-term and long-term solutions. We've heard a lot about the long-term solutions from the mayor, which is economic development, conflict resolution training, all of these things. But in the immediate time frame, something else needs to be done to slow these shootings. And we haven't heard any new ideas as to what could be done for that.
And what about bullets going into an apartment? What is done about that?
You know, I don't know what's done about that, Nick. I don't, you know, to Kat's point, that there are no solutions here that have come forward. The police have made tweaks here and there. There have been some changes to new policy. We had another call this week for the removal of Police Chief Rick Smith from civil rights leaders in town. No movement on that front either. It seems like on this issue, Nick, we are perpetually in a state of just being stuck. And creative new ideas, a spark here, a big change of one kind or another seems to be eluding us.
The mayor was on a gun control conference a few days ago with a couple of other mayors. He constantly expressed the frustration that pretty much everything he thinks that Kansas City ought to do from a legislative standpoint or an ordinance standpoint gets preempted by the legislature in Missouri. The fact of the matter is that more cops, I don't think, are going to solve this in and of itself.
I think it's more so the visibility of police. I think we're to the point now where people want to come down here and feel safe. And if you don't feel safe coming down here, chances are you're not going to come. So there's an economic issue here, and I would be more inclined to say just park a police car somewhere and let people know that there's a presence here, more so than police officers walking around. Right.
A couple of thoughts. You know, the pandemic is waning. The jazz community is eager and ready to get rolling again. Now we have these tragedies in the 18th and Vine District at the most inopportune time, Nick. And something, Eric's absolutely right. Something needs to happen, or a lot of people, a lot of jazz patrons aren't going to be coming down to 18th and Vine. The community has been waiting for a year to get this thing restarted again, and now this.
For the better part of a year now, there's been a steady drumbeat, as we've just heard, for about calls for the removal of Kansas City Police Chief Rick Smith. They have gone nowhere. Now the push has crossed over to the other side of our state line, to Johnson County's largest city. This week, black clergy and social justice activists held a press conference to demand the ouster of Overland Park Police Chief Frank Donchez. Why, Kat Reid?
Well, there have been a lot of critiques of the lack of transparency there. And, you know, the group is saying several scandals surrounding the chief. Particularly, they're focused on his handling of the shooting of 17-year-old John Albers. Of course, the officer involved shooting report wasn't released. We're expecting that release soon, finally. But that was after 41 Action News actually filed a lawsuit to get those records, which we argue should have been open in the first place. So that's one aspect. There's also the chief's handling of the protests last summer and kind of the crackdown on protesters who were out there. So there are several different factors, but it really comes down to transparency at the end of the day.
Kansas and Missouri have been taken down a peg or two this week. The numbers are in from the U.S. Census that we filled in last year, and it's going to force us to change our school textbooks and how we view ourselves in the future. No longer is Missouri America's 18th largest state. We're now 19th. Maryland has overtaken us. And if you live in Kansas, you've been taken down two pegs. Kansans can no longer say they live in the nation's 33rd largest state. Both Utah and Nevada have overtaken us. You're going to have to settle, if you live in Kansas, by the way, for saying you're the 35th largest state in the country now, which brings us to a fundamental question. Does size really matter? Other than bruised egos, what difference does it make, Micheal Mahoney, that Kansas and Missouri are shrinking in size relative to other states?
Well, there's a couple of things here. Number one, it's a sign of a lack of economic growth, and that is troubling, and that is something that's going to have to be dealt with, and it's not a quick fix. The other thing, because we got some political reporters on here, I'm going to bring this up. In Missouri, they're going to have to redistrict. Now, the Republicans are not going to look at freshman Congresswoman Cori Bush over in St. Louis, but they are putting Emanuel Cleaver in the 5th District on the target list as a possible pickup. In fact, the chairman of the party said to me in an interview this week, Nick Myers, we'd like the 5th District to be Republican, including the city of Kansas City. On the Johnson County side in Kansas, same thing is happening. For a year now, it's been an open secret that the Republicans, when they draw their lines, are going to try to make it as difficult as possible for Sharice Davids to win re-election by probably taking some Democratic voters out, giving her more Republican voters. They're going to do the same thing with Cleaver's district in Missouri. That is one of the immediate shakeouts on this.
So are they going to start rejigging those lines right now then in both states, Kat?
Well, the process is coming soon, and it's going to be very contentious, especially in Missouri, where voters ended up repealing Clean Missouri, which would have changed the redistricting process. And one thing that's kind of interesting is that, you know, they could use the state population from the census, or they could only use the citizen population. So only count citizens in that redrawing of the line. So that process, I think there will be a big fight over that, and we'll just have to see how it shakes out.
I will say in Kansas and Missouri, we're not losing any members of Congress in this redistricting shift. But I did see in New York State, Steve Kraske, it was just 89 people. If 89 more people had bothered to fill in their census, New York State wouldn't have lost one of its congressional seats. So the filling in this form does make a difference.
Oh, that's right, Nick, without any question. I just would point out that I think there are some big macro questions that policymakers in both our states need to wrestle with here. Yes, the populations of both states have increased, but at a much slower rate than most states around the country. Kansas's 3% population growth, Nick, the lowest uptick since 1900. So what does that say? It says that you begin to wonder about the policies, the conservative policies in both states. Are those policies enough to attract people to your state? And based on these numbers, at a minimum, questions arise as to whether that's the case or not. And we need to have a conversation about that.
My thing would be, how many people did they actually count? Because even though there was a little marketing strategy going on, there were probably a lot of people, especially in the Black community, that they didn't count. And those people that they didn't count didn't trust the system. We were going through the COVID thing. There was changing in the policy. So I don't know if the numbers are accurate, but it's accurate enough to do the redistricting.
There is a question about the numbers, and there is a question about who they will count. It may not be total population. It may be just citizens. Or the other one is it might be, in terms of redistricting, voters. And look for a special session, at least in Missouri, to deal with this, because there's not enough time left in this session, and they've got to get it squared away before candidates start filing for 2022.
This week, Missouri lawmakers still can't seem to break that stalemate over funding for Medicaid expansion, but that does not mean your local state representatives have been doing nothing. This week, they begin debate on a measure that would require women who get abortions to bury or cremate the fetal remains. Under the proposal, the woman would also bear the cost of the burial, which the bill requires to be included in the cost of the procedure. With so many other priorities competing for attention in Jefferson City, why is this bill considered so important to lawmakers, Kat Reid?
Well, I think it's part of a huge nationwide push. We've seen a lot of legislation like this, not only in Missouri, but it has been a priority for a lot of Republican lawmakers elsewhere. So I think that we're seeing this national push, and that's why that came to the forefront here in Missouri.
It came up already in the state of Indiana, where Mike Pence, the former governor, signed a very similar bill into law, Steve Kraske, and the United States Supreme Court said it was constitutional.
Yeah, and I just would point out that this bill in Missouri is not even out of the House yet as we tape this, Nick. Its chances for passage, it could pass, but it's less likely given how little time is left in the session. And I just would point out, based on our last segment here, does this kind of legislation result in people being attracted to come to a state like Missouri, or is it repelling a lot of people? You know, does that have an impact on the census numbers? Arguably, it might.
I did mention also the Medicaid expansion there. Micheal Mahoney, I mean, is that a done deal now that they're not going to, they've stalemated, their money is not coming, and this is just going to end up in a courtroom somewhere?
As everybody that's covered a state legislature or a city council meeting knows, nothing is dead until the gavel comes down and yes, things are adjourned. Now, Wednesday night, the state Senate in Missouri, I think they killed off Medicaid expansion in the state budget, but I also expect it'll be coming back for another charge in the final weeks of the session. And if that doesn't happen, then there will be a lawsuit that will be filed by perhaps the AARP or another group like that. They'll identify an injured plaintiff and file a lawsuit on their behalf. And there may be another special session dealing with Medicaid expansion because of a lawsuit like this.
Local governments, including right here in Kansas City, are collectively getting $350 billion in federal aid from Washington as part of what is called the American Rescue Plan. But how do you know they won't just squander the cash on all sorts of questionable projects? This week, Missouri lawmakers are on that too. They began work this week on a measure that would allow them to review cities' pandemic aid spending. Mayor Quinton Lucas is horrified.
In some ways, it's inherent racism to continue to suggest time and time again that cities, particularly your larger blue cities, the ones with most of the Black folks, most of the Latinos, most of the minorities, and a number of others, are the ones that actually don't know how to handle their own money.
Money, a little clip there at the end. He says it's racist and insulting, but as taxpayers, why wouldn't we want to make sure there's no abuse or fraud taking place? Isn't that a good thing, Eric Wesson?
Yeah, it's a good thing, but the way they framed it is kind of questionable because they didn't say anything about Springfield or areas down in the Boot Hill. They specifically said Kansas City and St. Louis. So I think that's where he kind of got upset or irritated. But it is a good thing to have oversight, but let's talk about other areas too.
I remember Kat Reid last year, for instance, on the other side of the state line, Overland Park wanted to use some of its pandemic relief money to put up floodlights at its soccer stadium and then backed off after a lot of public pressure over that. So, you know, money, we don't know where the money is going, right?
Well, there are people who are supposed to be keeping track of this. And if you look at Missouri, there already is oversight from the state auditor. Nicole Galloway has oversight over how these funds are used. I think when you, if you want to understand kind of the anger, the frustration, especially from the mayor, you have to go back to the first, the round of CARES Act money, which, you know, the counties, it went directly to them. And then the counties, you know, the city had to fight for any money. And so there's a lot of, I think, frustration that, okay, we finally have this money and we're going to use it to help with COVID relief. And now people are wanting to look over our shoulder. So there's a long history to this frustration.
You know, I've mentioned on this program before, we have a viewer in Kansas by the name of John who routinely emails me to say how many minutes we spend talking about Missouri on this program and how many minutes we talk about Kansas. So I want to end with Kansas here because Kansas Governor Laura Kelly may be suffering from a severe case of focal dystonia of the fingers this week. We more commonly call it writer's cramp. She's just come off a mammoth session of vetoing almost every major bill lawmakers send to her desk. That includes measures banning transgender athletes from competing in girls' sports to tax cuts and election law changes. Oh, and also a bill that would have lowered the age of to carry a concealed weapon in Kansas to just 18. She couldn't find anything to like, Steve Kraske?
Well, I think she really struggled, Nick. I think there's a lot of political gamesmanship going on here. To some extent, we're seeing Republicans sort of set the stage for the 2022 election year. Governor Kelly's going to be seeking a second term against a couple of Republican frontrunners there. We're seeing Republicans really set the stage and coming up with campaign ads, if you will, that they can push at Governor Kelly for saying no to items that are pretty popular in conservative circles, if not in Democratic ones.
So this is about a squeeze for next year's election, Micheal Mahoney?
This is exactly the opening round of the 2022 gubernatorial campaign, and this is the first act of the first scene, and it's taking place in the legislature. And just this week, the Democratic Governors Association came out with a commercial that was casting Derek Schmidt and Jeff Collier as the handmaidens of Sam Brownback, and they did it sort of as a Night of the Living Dead, made it gave it sort of a horror movie pitch to it. They're going to be involved in this. Kelly is the one of the most vulnerable governors up. She's the only Democratic governor on the ballot next year in a state that Trump won. And so this is the opening salvos of the 2022 gubernatorial election campaign in the state of Kansas. And it'll play out more this coming week when the lawmakers in Kansas go back for their veto session, where they, among other things, have to craft a school budget bill. And they've got the state Supreme Court looking over their shoulder on that.
So they could still overturn a lot of these measures just vetoed by the governor this week. When you put a program like this together, you can't get to every major story making the headlines. What was the big local story we missed? Not sure exactly what's happening here, but many of the homeless recently placed in hotels by the city are now moving out. It's unclear whether they were being disruptive or the hotel staff was being disrespectful or management was price gouging the city on room rates. Now the city announcing plans to build a tiny homes village for the homeless. The Biden administration says it will not reverse a Trump-era decision to move two large agencies of the USDA to Kansas City. The offices will stay. Kansas City, Kansas schools hiring a new superintendent, and the co-founder of the National Museum of Toys and Miniatures has died. Kansas City philanthropist Barbara Marshall was 97 years old. Starting Monday, twice as many seats up for grabs at Kauffman Stadium, the Royals nearly doubling the number of fans who can watch games in person. And a Kansas City man being celebrated by the movie-making world, Peter Spears, got to stand on stage at the Oscars Sunday night as Nomadland won Best Picture. Spears is the film's co-producer. He was born in Kansas City, Missouri, later moving to Overland Park and graduating from Shawnee Mission South High School. Was it one of those stories that you picked, Kat Reid, or something completely different?
You know, I want to go back to a story we did discuss, but an aspect that we missed, which is about Aviva, the KCUR reporter, immensely talented, who was shot and killed. If her story breaks your heart and if you want to support journalists in her honor, KCUR and KBIA have established a fund in Aviva's honor that you can donate to. I would encourage people to check that out.
Eric Wesson.
I chose the homeless people being put out of the hotel or had a deal for $100 a night per room. It wound up being $2.3 million total, and now they want a little more money. And the people there saying that, hey, they don't want to move because now they've got jobs in the area at the Denny's restaurant and at the other restaurant around there. So now they don't want to move, and now they're blaming it on the city for not doing something about it.
Complicated business, that. Micheal Mahoney.
The fact the Royals are increasing their attendance threshold is a good sign of progress. Also sort of speaks to the fact that they're having a pleasantly nice start. Larger question is the Biden decision to keep the USDA jobs that were shifted here in Kansas City staying in Kansas City. The USDA and the bureaucrats back in the D.C. area don't like that, but it's good for the community here.
Steve Kraske.
I just want to amplify one of Micheal Mahoney's last points. As we tape this today, the Kansas City Royals have the best winning percentage in Major League Baseball. I got to end this show on a positive note. That's a remarkable achievement. They're off to a great start. It's something to get excited about in what's been a really rough week.
Absolutely. Before we leave you, by the way, congratulations to Kat Reid on her big promotion. Some viewers say she won't appear on the show anymore now that she's been named Chiefs head coach. An eagle-eyed viewer pointing this one out, Carter says, there are certainly worse people to be mistaken for. My big question, Kat, do you plan to rejigger the offensive line?
Yeah, you know, I think there's some changes, and I'd like to add more horses. I don't think it should just be war paint. There should be several other horses on the field.
All right. Other than that, we will say we've not only reviewed the news, we've also overstated our welcome. Thank you to Channel 9's Micheal Mahoney, The Call's Eric Wesson, Mr. Up to Date, weekdays at 9 on KCUR FM, Steve Kraske, and Andy Reid. I mean, Kat Reid from 41 Action News. I'm Nick Haines from all of us at Kansas City PBS. Be well, keep calm, and carry on.